A very common question that we get from our audience is, how do I get work? Now, you can focus on sales, inbound and outbound marketing, or you could be so fortunate to have an amazing sales rep. What is a rep? What do they do? How do they do what they do? These are things that we're going to be talking about with our guest in the studio today. Her name is Andrea Stern. What does a photographer's rep do?
We are the voice for the photographer. We negotiate fees. We handle the managing of their portfolio.
You're an ally to the artist, really, is what you are.
Yeah.
I like that.
I want to be their voice. I'm here. That's my job. Keep them in front of people and speak for them and protect them.
Mm. I like that. Is that on your website?
No. Write that down somewhere.
That'd be good.
I'd like to find out a little bit more about kind of a typical case about how you work with your artists.
The one biggest part is not to talk money. I'm the one that talks money. Even if a photographer's asked to add shots for the shoot, they're supposed to say, I'd love to, but you have to talk to my rep. Mm-hmm. It kind of makes me the bad guy in a good way.
Mm-hmm. I think my photography is pretty good, but I can't get any real leads. And I'd love to work on advertising on these big brands that we just saw. How do I go about getting a rep? And then how does this whole process work? And what do you look for in terms of people to work with?
Best way to get a rep is to have great work, because you'll be found. There's so many ways that people find you and want to hire the photographer, and then you get to meet the people in the business, and then the communication starts. So really just get your work out there.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like we have a different position now, because photographers have to be really involved in a way they did not before. I'm not just the voice. They have to be the voice too. Because without Instagram, without hashtags, we worked with this art producer, and she told me they had a client meeting. They were looking for, let's say, a dark and moody portrait shooter. She at the meeting under the table with her phone looking up hashtags, dark, moody, portrait.
Mm.
She was coming up with photographers through hashtags at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is today's world.
Technology has made it easier for artists to find clients and clients to find artists.
Yes.
And I want to share a story with you just real quick. There's a guy who used to work for me as a photographer, and he started posting and building a decent following on Instagram. He's probably up to like 40, 50,000 people now. And Apple found one of his images that he took with his iPhone, and they wanted to use it for a billboard. So then he came and asked me, Chris, how much should I negotiate this image for? What's going to happen? And being that he's a rookie at negotiating for his images, he probably could have done better for himself. And so how would somebody like that say, okay, look, I have an opportunity to work with Apple. Should they reach out to a rep and have you step in and help out? Or do you have any advice on this or thoughts?
Yep.
How do you structure your fees? How does this work?
The temp repping depends on the situation, but the normal rate is 25%.
What are some typical fees for, like, say, a one-day shoot, a product still life?
Day rates can go between $2,500 to $20,000.
Okay. I'm a photographer, and I can make somewhere on a day rate $2,500 to $25,000, but then you also talked about usage, and so how might that impact the creative fees altogether?
If the usage is big, the money should be big too, because the photographer's usage is based on their image, how many people are seeing it.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of simple in that way.
Mm-hmm.
But if they can get more specific, like not full buyout, they often call it, or buying the copyright, or unlimited usage, but if they can say 1 year print or 1 year social media, the more fine-tuned they can get like that, the smaller we feel, in general, us, that we can bring down our creative fee day rate.
Okay, so if the usage is very limited and the time in which they're using it for is limited, then relatively speaking, the fees will be a little bit lower. And on the opposite end of the spectrum, on the far right there, if they want a buyout exclusive usage, they want to just own the image, then the price is going to be very high, I assume, right?
Right. And it's also where? Worldwide,
okay.
It's often called global.
Okay.
And nowadays with internet, you know, you can't say just California.
Right.
But if it's print or something else, it's... where is it going?
Okay, so if it's, say, a national buy for 1 year, and one image, what might that be in terms of creative fees for one of your top-tier guys?
I would say 6,000, 7,000.
Okay.
Hmm?
And then if it were the same exact situation, but it was global for 1 year? How might that impact the price?
I would try to go up, and again, this really, and to me, this is negotiation. Mm-hmm. I try to get a feel of the client.
Yes.
We make it global. It's going to go up 3,000.
Okay, so it went from 6K to 9K for a single image. Now, okay, basically.
Oh, not a single image, a day.
A day, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, so basically, some of our audience really struggle with this concept that they struggle with the idea of ethics or in the work, and they measure their energy, how much time they spend on something, and they price according to that. And they don't price according to the client or the usage or how much value it is to the client. Why can you justify that one image, the same effort, let's say, from the same photographer can be drastically different from client to client? How do you help our audience understand this? Okay, so like say I'm Toby, because I do know Toby. I'm trying not to say anything that I shouldn't be saying, because I do know his business quite well, right?
Yes.
So if I'm Toby and I set up a still life thing, like say a bottle, a beauty shot for a bottle, why can he charge a different price depending on who's walking in the door and what they're asking for, even though it's essentially a bottle shoot?
Well, that's part of what makes this is who's the client? What budget do they have? And again, that's where I feel like I come across in an important way is to negotiate. Find out what do they have? I mean, it's kind of a simple question. And the other hard part of that is clients are not going to tell you what they have.
Mm-hmm.
So there's ways to ask questions to get the answer.
Can you share some of those tips with us, please?
Yeah. Actually happened this morning, and I did.
I'm sure it happens every day for you, right?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, okay.
I guess I can say it honestly. Is I said to the client in an email,
mm-hmm.
and someone out there watching might be seeing this.
It's okay.
I said, okay, so this sounds like you'd have like between 10 and 15 grand, and I ask it as a question. And I knew that honestly would be a little high.
Mm-hmm.
My goal is for them to say, "Ooh, no, that's a little high."
Mm-hmm.
So that gives us information.
Right. Okay. So what you guys are doing, and our audience is a very educated, sophisticated kind of creative entrepreneur. What we're talking about is your price bracketing, and you're anchoring high to get a feel for
yes.
how they might respond. And your job is always to anchor high because you want them to talk you down versus shooting too low.
Absolutely.
And this is the value that you provide to your clients, to your photographers, because somebody might go in there and undersell it. So where my buddy sold his image to Apple for very low money, in my opinion, for a billboard
mm-hmm.
worldwide usage, he could have benefited by having somebody like you. So I don't want you guys to sit there and think, I have to pay somebody else 25% of the creative fees when you probably are on likelihood getting 4, 5, 10 times as much as you probably could get on your own.
That's right.
So 25% seems like a bargain to me.
It's like 25% of what?
Yeah.
To protect the photographer. Oh my God, there's that whole spot on the estimate for description of job. So important. How many hours? No overtime's included. What if something changes? This bid is based on the PDF of the layouts that we've received. If something changes, who's covering it? That kind of stuff. What are you shooting? Is it on white? Is there an environment behind it? Like apples to apples. We got to get clear with each other. So mm-hmm. that paragraph of description is so important.
A lot of creative people are going to look at you like a guardian angel. You talked about writing clear descriptions and in what we call it just like the scope of work document to make sure it's well defined, because in the gray area, some clients can take advantage of you. If the scope grows,
mm-hmm.
the artist has a friend like on the Batmobile, you know, or the Batline just calling you up and saying, Andrea, it's going to get bigger. Talk to my rep. And then you can go in and say, okay, here's what we negotiated for. Now you're changing it. So now you're going to go get more money for the artist, right?
Yes. And I actually just thought of a story because I was on a job. I was sitting with a creative and art producer, and Toby was over there shooting. And the creative said to the other creative, oh, let's also shoot it this way.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. And the other guy says to the other guy, yeah, let's add two more shots and shoot that way. Okay. And then the art director looks at the art producer right there, and he says to her, oh, yeah, so we want to add that. She says, oh, okay. And then she texts me or emails me, and I'm sitting across the table from her.
Okay.
And she said, okay, so how much to add those two shots?
Right.
Like they... It's such a weird system, and that's why I suggest assisting if you don't know these things, you got to know when you can speak. Who do you speak to? What's your role? Do you stay in front of people? Do you ask even people, how are they? Can I get you some water? There's rules and a system. So the art producer asks me that, and then we work it out, and I get up and I go talk to Toby and talk about, can you add this? Will it add any cost? Will we need to get dinner for the night? Any overtime? How much time will it take you? How much for retouching? And then I have to call Kaz. How much is that going to? So it's not something that just happens at the table in front of everyone.
Mm-hmm. So here's what I'm thinking. I can imagine that there are some people in our audience where they're going to earn somewhere between $5,000 to $9,000 a year in parts of the world. And you're talking about $5,000 to $9,000 for a day's rate, right? And so they're sitting here thinking, oh my gosh, how do I get a rep like you? How do I get your attention? What are some tips or advice? I know you have a very limited roster. You only have five companies or people right now. How do I get the attention of somebody like you to help me? And you sound like the answer to all my prayers.
You get your book ready, and then you're going to get a rep. They're going to come after you. If your book is ready and you're ready to work and you're marketable, yes.
Okay. What makes for marketable work?
Can you see it on a job for a print? Can you see it? Can it, a video? Can you see it when you're on the website for a company? Does your work reflect that? I always call it hyper reality. Nowadays with Instagram, hyper reality is a less produced, more real, authentic. I'm telling you, every creative call, and I can tell you what a creative call is, I hear real, natural, organic, authentic,
yes,
genuine, relatable, believable. These words, that's all we're hearing right now. So your work has to fit within today's produced, yet not looking produced, and really just look around, do your research, and look up photographers who are really successful. Go on workbook.com and look up photographers. It's quite easy.